Everyone, welcome to our first class of our Beginners Talmud class for women. I'm very excited to teach this class. Just a little bit about myself, starting and standing, for those of you who I haven't yet met. And my family just moved here in the summer to Toronto. We were living in Michigan, working on campus at University of Michigan. And now we're here and I work at Olpana. I teach Judaic studies and I teach two Talmud classes. So this is kind of my jam. And I've been very privileged to be in many places where I had the opportunity to learn Gemara. And I feel privileged that I had those opportunities. And so I'm really excited to be able to open those doors up to those of you. And I'm curious to hear people's backgrounds in learning Talmud and, you know, why you decided to come to this class. Whether you're a beginner or not, I think this is still valuable. If you are a beginner, then great. This is going to be, you know, a perfect opportunity. If you're not a beginner, I hope it will give you a different perspective, allow you to learn Gemara from the beginner's eyes, and allow you to really take a few steps back at what you maybe have been doing previously. I'm particularly excited about this class because I feel like there are so many barriers towards learning Gemara, let alone for women, but because so many women don't have the opportunity to learn Gemara for all sorts of reasons. But just in general, that Talmud is very inaccessible to a lot of people for a variety of reasons. Number one, the language. I don't know if any of you are well-versed in Aramaic, but probably not. And that's a real challenge. So that's number one. Number two, there's no punctuation in Talmud. That makes it really difficult to read. So even if you know Hebrew or maybe even Aramaic, but it's very difficult to understand, to string sentences together and know where to start, where to stop, what's happening in each moment. And the last reason, I think, is because it is so cryptic. It is written in such a cryptic style. It's so tightly written. There are so many words missing. There's so much explanation that's lacking that you can really only understand it with interpretation. And so that is so many layers of learning that it's hard to just pick it up independently. So we're gonna jump on in. Just by a show of hands, first of all, if you can put on your videos, that would be great, because it's always nice to see faces. If you can, I totally understand. But if you can, it's always nice to talk to faces. Just by a show of hands, raise your hand if you have spent significant time learning Talmud in your past. Uh-oh. Okay. All right, so a few people. And raise your hand if this is really beginning for you. This is really a very new opportunity. Okay, so we have a mix, which is kind of really nice. So everyone can bring their backgrounds together. And my goal here is we're gonna do three classes. They're gonna build on each other. Although if somebody misses one, you can still come. We'll catch you up. The goal here is to really give you an opportunity to actually get into the text and experience what it's like to learn a passage of Talmud, of Gemara. You know, not just come out with the ideas and the conclusions, but really experience what are the questions that we're faced with when we're learning a passage of Talmud. What are the questions that previous interpreters have dealt with when tackling this text? What tools are there to help us as we face these challenges? I want us to experience that process together. So with that, let's begin with just a little bit of history. I'm not here to give you a whole history class, but I just want to establish the basics for those of you who know this. Great review. Otherwise, then I'm glad if this will be the first time that you're learning this. Let's talk about the Torah, the very general word, the Torah. The Torah is split into written law and oral law, Torah Shebichtav and Torah Shebaalpeh. And our tradition tells us that they were both given at Har Sinai. They were both given to Moses at Har Sinai, Mount Sinai, but one was written down and then one was transmitted orally. And the written Torah, we kept on adding books to it, turning into the Tanakh for centuries later. And the oral Torah was just passed on through word of mouth from generation to generation. At a certain point, the written law, the Torah Shebaal Bichtav, was closed. No more books were added. And so now we have that, the canon of the written text. And now we have also these oral traditions. And they were just passed on and on. And actually the way they were passed on is they were memorized. They were repeated from person to person, and people would actually memorize the conversations. At a certain point, it was decided that this is no longer going to work. We're going to lose this oral tradition. We have to write it down, even though it's not meant to be written down, even though there was actually even a prohibition against writing it down for a variety of reasons. We can have a whole class on just any of these historical decisions and situations. But Rabbi Yehuda HaNasi, Rabbi Judah the Prince, decided it was time. And he collected all of these different statements and conversations and repeated discussions, and he collected them into a work. That's called the Mishnah. And that's the beginning of, in a way, the study of the oral law, the Torah Sheval Peh, because that's the first time that it's written down. Beforehand, it was just repeated and repeated, and it's written down. And Mishnah, the word Mishnah actually comes from the word to repeat. It actually means to repeat, like Vishinantam Levanecha in Shema, it actually means to repeat, because they were just repeated statements, and then finally they were written. They were collected in one work, the Mishnah. The problem was, Rabbi Yehuda HaNasi thought, okay, great, it's all here, it's all clear, but it wasn't so clear. And there are so many questions that people kept on having. So instead of being just finished, we wrote it down and we're done, now this was another springboard for further conversation. And more people started to talk about it and analyze it. And that later discussion is called the Gemara. So put the Mishnah and the Gemara together, and that's called Talmud. I can repeat that. We have the Mishnah, we have the Gemara, later conversations about it, put it together, that's the Talmud. Okay, I have actually two Talmuds here, just from our lovely big Midrash, Achari Shemayim. This is one. I have another big one here. And so we're now going to look at a page of Talmud. Let's see what we have. Actually, just before we do that, just one other discussion that I want to share is that after we have the Talmud, even the Talmud's not so clear. As we mentioned, there are many reasons why that's not so clear. And so then we have all these later commentaries. The most famous of them, the most famous one is Rashi. After that, the second most famous one is probably Tosfot, which is a collection of commentaries by actually largely people who are relatives of Rashi, some of his grandchildren. And then there are so many other commentaries. They're found in the actual text, on the page of the Talmud, or in the back of the Talmud, or in separate books. I mean, it's endless. If you come into this Beit Midrash, on the wall behind me, there are so many commentators. And still to this day, people are still writing interpretations, either directly on the Talmud or interpretations of the Talmud. It's amazing how this spiral of oral Torah is still going. It's not ending. And that's what's so exciting about learning Talmud, is that we're really plugging into a very ancient conversation, but we're continuing that conversation. We're renewing it, right? We're continuing that spiral, the same issues, but now in modern day. Now, what does that mean in our lives today? How do we apply it? How do we understand it? New insights. And so it's very exciting to really be a part of this process. Before I move forward, does anyone have any questions? Feel free to make this as interactive as you would like. I would love it to be interactive. So feel free to just shout out a question. If at any point you're wondering about anything or anything wasn't clear, really feel free to ask. Good to go? Okay. Let's look at our page of Talmud. So you can look at your source sheet. This is the opening page of the source sheet. And so I want to point out a few things for those of you who have never navigated a page of Talmud. So you see in the center of the page, I didn't show it on my page, center is right at the beginning, that is the Mishnah. And it starts with Erev Pesachim. That's the Mishnah. And then about 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 lines down, you might see a little Gimel Mem, it's bolded. That's the beginning of the Gemara. So the Mishnah is the older conversation, and the Gemara then begins the analysis of that. And that's the center of the page, because that's really the primary focus here, the Mishnah and the Gemara. But all around, you see different commentaries. So on one side, on the left side, my left side, your left side, that's Rashi's commentary. In this situation, we also have Rashbam, which is his grandson, on the same side. And on the other side, we have the commentary of Tosfot. So that's the immediate rectangle around the center. But then around that, we have another layer. And if you look on one side, I'm not going to go into the specifics here, but just some of the examples of what these are. Some of them are resources that tell us if this passage is quoted somewhere else in the Talmud, where is it quoted? We'll cross-reference. Or if there are particular emendations of different versions of this text, then that will be noted there. Or if a fascinating one is called the Ein Mishpat Ner Mitzvah, if you look over here on the top right, that is a later work that someone did to connect all of the statements in the Talmud to major halachic works. Where do they come up? So the Shulchan Aruch and Rambam's Mishneh Torah and the Tur. It will tell you where in those works this idea comes up as a halachic principle. So if you want to learn halacha, not just the Gemara, but actually what we should do with that, then you can go there. So it's an amazing tool. And there are other commentaries. So that's just kind of navigating the page. And the last thing is the top. If you'll see, it starts with Arve Psachim, which is the name of the chapter, and Perach Asiri, the 10th chapter, and Psachim, that's the name of the Masechet, which I'll talk about in a moment, and Sadi Tet, two dots, means Sadi Tet Amad Bet, which is 99b, because each page has two sides. Just a little bit also about the division of Talmud, that the Mishnah was written, organized into six different sections called Sidarim, and each Seder is then divided into various masechtot, smaller sections, and then a tractate. And then each tractate or masechet then divided into prakim, to chapters. So what we're learning here, one more division is a daf, a page. People who learn daf yomi, what they're learning is two sides of one page of the Talmud. And that takes 7.5 years to go through the cycle. So what we're learning together is masechet psachim, tractate psachim. Which is in Seder Moed, the Seder that's devoted to specific times in the Jewish calendar, the first one being Shabbat, Shabbos, and then all the other holidays are in there. So we're learning Masechet Psachim. And we're learning the 10th Perek. What's interesting about Masechet Psachim is that there are actually 9 other chapters before this Perek, but they are not nearly as famous. Anyone know why? Anyone ever learned Psachim? I don't even know why. So if you think about it from the perspective of a Jew living during the times of the Beit HaMikdash, your primary concern was the Korban Pesach, was the sacrifice that you had to give. And so the first 9 chapters are primarily about sacrifice, Korban Pesach. The last chapter, the last parak, is about our practices today. Post-destruction, our Seder. This chapter is all about the various aspects of the Seder. Now, we're only going to learn the first Mishnah, but if you continued on in this chapter, you'd read about the 4 cups of wine, you'd read about Magid, what story do we tell, the Manishtana, all the different parts of the Seder. So it's really relevant to us, which is why so many people really love learning this chapter, because it's so relevant. It's something we just understand. Any questions? Feel free, any comments, thoughts, anything. Really, don't hesitate to speak up if you're wondering anything. Okay. All right. Let's now.
Can I just ask one question? The Yerushalayim Talmud and the Babylonian, are they both set up the same way, the same divisions?
Thank you for bringing that up. I meant to talk about that. So there are actually 2 different Talmuds written. There was one Mishnah, but then there were 2 different versions of the analysis on that. One was written in Babylonia, it's called the Talmud Bavli, and one was written in Israel. It's called the Talmud Yerushalmi, the Jerusalem Talmud, although it wasn't actually written in Jerusalem, it was written up north, but 2 different commentaries. The Jerusalem Talmud, the Talmud Yerushalmi is older, it was written first, and the Talmud Bavli was written about 100 years later. They both have the same setup in terms of analyzing the Mishnah. They're different in that they actually don't comment on the exact same masechtot, the same tractates, because neither one comments on every single tractate of Mishnah. So they actually choose different ones. Like, for example, all the agricultural laws, only the Yerushalmi talks about, not the Bavli. And they're slightly different languages, more Hebrew in the Yerushalmi as opposed to Aramaic in the Bavli. So they're slightly different. At the end of the day, our tradition has always deferred to the Talmud Bavli, but the Talmud Yerushalmi is still a very important resource that we look to. It just doesn't carry the same weight as the Bavli, but they're both important. I don't know if that fully addressed your question. You're asking about the setup. Yeah, that's good. Okay, great. Any other questions?
Israel, they're more, I mean, you talk about agricultural law. Yeah. So this now becomes very important since we're back. So they on that one, and we in the Galut are more on this one.
Okay, I don't know if you could hear the question. Roberta's asking, now that we're in Israel and so many of the agricultural laws are relevant, so now do we look more to the Yerushalmi for that? It's a good question. I would guess the answer is yes.
Like we have Shemitah, right?
And right.
All of those rules and the farmers and so on, they have to be looking for that.
Yeah. So I would guess that the Yerushalmi is, I mean, I know in recent times the Yerushalmi has become more accessible. Like even Art Scroll just recently, I believe, put out English of it. Like people are starting to learn it more and more. Maybe that's just reflective of the general growth of Torah learning. But I'm curious also if it's related maybe to the focus in Israel. I don't know. It's interesting. Interesting point. I don't know. It's a good question. Any other questions? No? All right, let's dive in. So turn to page 2. What you'll see here is all English. The reason why I did that is because I want you to actually experience what it's like to learn Talmud without the barriers of language. But if you knew the language, what would that be like? Right? Let's put that barrier aside. And this was what I call the raw version. This is just the literal as possible in translation of the words of the original. If you want to follow along in the original, you're welcome to look at the original page. But if you want to follow along in English, that's what I give you here. There are no extra words added. You're going to see it's awkward. And this is going to be the struggle to figure it out. Okay. So let's begin. Any volunteers to read?
Yeah,
go for it. English.
I got the English.
Okay.
Mishnah, the eve of Passover adjacent to Mincha, a person not eat until dark, even the poorest of Jews not eat until he reclines, and they should not give him less than 4 cups of wine, and even from the charity plate.
Okay, everyone, just read that to yourself again. Just the Mishnah, the raw version of the Mishnah. And let's just think, if you were reading this and there was no Gemara yet, right? There's no Talmud yet on it. There's no Gemara yet on this. What would not be so clear to you? What would you want to understand more? We're just going to throw out all our questions. So everybody, let's all do this together. Okay. Feel free to just speak up. Let's get our questions out. Yeah. Zahava, go for it.
What's adjacent to Mincha? Okay, when is adjacent to Mincha?
Okay. So what does it mean adjacent? And I think there's another question there. Not just what does it mean adjacent, but when's Mincha? What does that mean? Right? Okay. Other questions? Am I going to have to cold call like I do to my students when we're on Zoom? Aviva, is that you? Yeah.
Yeah. It says not eat. So is that should not eat or is forbidden from eating?
Okay, so the eve of Passover adjacent to Mincha, a person not eat. Good. So is that saying that should not eat, or what was the alternative?
Forbidden.
Okay, good. Or maybe it's even saying they just don't in reality, right? Like, who knows? Okay, good. So what missing word is in front of not? We need to add another word there, right? So you're assuming should, but maybe it's can't or does not eat.
Must not eat,
right? Like those all have subtle differences. Okay, what else?
The part about the poor and the charity plate and the wine to me is all very confusing.
Okay, what specifically is confusing?
So I guess if you assume that the person who's poor needs to eat, maybe they're hungry, then why are we, what's the reclining and the 4 cups of wine part to have to do with that?
Okay, so you're saying that why are we relating the poorest of Jews to, like, what does reclining and giving him four cups of wine like have to do with being poor?
Yeah.
Okay. That's a good question. I think you're making an assumption there.
Maybe.
Can anyone catch Rachel's assumption there? There's actually another way to read that statement. That instead of the poorest of Jews relating to the words that come after it, you could say that it's actually following the words that come before it. You see that?
Even the poorest of Jews.
Yeah.
Like putting a punctuation mark after Jews.
Exactly, right? Like, where's the period? Is the period before even or after Jews? And that's going to have a completely different meaning. So first of all, how do we punctuate this? Right, you see, this is the challenge of Mishnah and then later Gemara. We don't know how to punctuate it. And whatever side you put it on, you're then going to ask, what's the relationship between being poor and the concept? Like whether it's about reclining or about not eating till dark, what does it have to do with being poor? Mm-hmm. What's the relationship? Why do we have to say even a poor person has to can't do this? Okay, great. What else? What's a charity plate? Great question. What's a charity plate? Okay. What else?
How about why is there a reference to the eve of Passover and then not until dark? Like, what's the difference in time between those two references? Or are they
okay.
the same?
Okay, good question. So what is the eve of Passover exactly? What's the relationship there between dark and the eve of Passover? Is it the same thing? Is it different times? Mm-hmm. What's that talking about? Yep. Great. What else?
Is the four cups of wine and the charity plate, is that talking about the person? Like, it's talking about poor people and it's talking about just a person. So does that second part apply to both poor people and the person referred to at the beginning?
You're saying, wait, so.
It says they should not give him less than four cups of wine.
Okay. And
from the charity plate. Is that talking about a poor person?
Or you're saying anybody?
Mm-hmm. Because it talks at the beginning about a person should not
person. Eat. Right. Okay. So the later parts of the Mishnah, like how does it connect to the earlier parts? Mm-hmm. Good question. Anyone have any why questions here? Like just thinking more broadly?
Who's the they?
Okay, who's the they?
They should not Good. Give him less than four cups of wine.
Good, who's the they? Clearly someone has a responsibility here, who? Let's keep pushing a little bit more. Let's come up with a few more questions. We're doing great so far. I'm gonna just go back to some basics. That's things we might take for granted because we've experienced a Seder. Why do we need to recline? Why do we need to have four cups of wine? Can we have more than four cups of wine?
And the phraseology and even from the charity plate seems misplaced. Like why doesn't say Jews shall not eat? You wouldn't drink from the charity plate, you'd eat from the charity plate. So why is that phrase put after the wine, not relating to the eating?
Okay, so you're definitely assuming that a charity plate is related to food as opposed to drinks, wine.
Or maybe it's neither. Maybe it's take. Maybe there's a missing word. It should be take from the charity plate rather than.
All right. Oh, so maybe it's a take. And people here are suggesting maybe it's not related to like literally serving food, but it's actually just money towards something. So good question, though. Good question. How do all the pieces fit together? Right. The last question I want to just throw out also is that we clearly learn a number of laws here. We learn the idea. Some certain things are definitely clear here, even if we don't know the details of it. Right. But that you can't eat until dark on the eve of Passover, that you have to recline, you have to have four cups of wine. Right. I'd say those things are for sure. Is all this unique to Passover, to Pesach? is any of this related to other times? Is this
only Shabbos? You're not supposed to eat before
Kippur. Okay, so maybe there's other times. Are there other times in the year when also we have to possibly wait to eat? Yeah. Maybe on Shabbos, right? Why are we only singling out Pesach? Is it related to other times? Is it not? We're going to have to see. That's actually going to be the subject of the Gemara that we're going to look at. Any last questions, comments, thoughts on the Mishnah?
Well, just also why? Like if you're going to ask why can't someone eat in whatever the time period is?
Okay, so why can't someone eat? Exactly, good, right? Why do they have to wait until dark? And if this is unique to Pesach, to Passover, then why specifically on Pesach, on Passover? And if it's not unique, then why are we only mentioning it in this context, right? So those are all excellent questions. Okay, let's now, before we go on to the Gemara, I want to go down to the commentary of Rashi, because that is traditionally, if you were to read this Mishnah, the first thing that you would do is look towards the commentary of Rashi. Okay, what does Rashi add for me? And we just have to appreciate that Rashi knew Gemara and learned Gemara without Rashi, right? So it sounds so simple, but it's pretty major. He didn't have a commentary like that to help him. So it's really tremendous what he offers us as we learn. So let's read the commentary of Rashi. Roberta, do you want to read this? You could say no, you don't want to.
The eve of Passover, close to Mincha, a little before Mincha.
Okay, pause there. Zahava, you got an answer?
Kind of. I mean, what's a little? Right.
What's a little?
How much is a little?
Now you have another question. What's a little? Right? Okay, so we're not exactly clear. No. I mean, it's definitely some point before, but we don't know still how much. And we also don't really know what Mincha is. Right, so we're going to talk about that. Okay, keep going, Roberta.
Not eat, so that he will eat matzah of mitzvah with appetite because of beautifying the mitzvah.
So what do you think Rashi is trying to address here that wasn't clear from the Mishnah? Anyone, feel free to call out.
Basically, if you're eating, then you're like taking away from the beauty of the mitzvah of eating the mitzvah, and you're being too full. You have no appetite. You want to enjoy mitzvah.
Good. So then what's the question? What's the question that he's answering?
He's not saying necessarily that you have to starve or that you shouldn't eat anything. You should eat in moderation so that you will still be able to.
Okay, you're all jumping. You're dancing around it. What's the question? What's the question that he's answering? Why can't we
eat until Mincha?
Right. Why do we have to wait? Right. Like the book, What's Bothering Rashi? Right. Like,
yes.
You really understand if you pinpoint exactly what his question was. Right. Why do you have to wait? What's the reason? And what he's saying is because this is a special matzah of mitzvah. Matzah shel mitzvah in Hebrew. And you have to eat it with appetite because that's the way that we beautify the mitzvah. Does this clarify things? Does this open up more questions for you?
Yeah.
Okay. What further questions do you think this might open up now?
Well, I don't think it was related to the forest of Jew.
Oh, okay. Well, we're actually going to come to that. Let's wait till the next commentary. Rashi is going to talk about it, but good.
How much is getting you, like what the quantity gets you to, be able to eat with appetite, or what is the mitzvah of what it is you need to eat?
So what do you really need to eat? And is there any,
how much
matzah? Okay. So what does it mean to eat matzah with appetite?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. I'm wondering, are there any other mitzvot that we have where we want to have appetite for it? Because would this be relevant in any other scenarios? That you want to beautify the mitzvah, you want to eat it hungrily. So you want to wait. Okay, so again, coming up with Shabbos. It's a great parallel. Is this parallel to Shabbos, to Shabbat? Is it the same thing where there's a mitzvah and we want to enjoy it, we want to appreciate it? So do you guys think that would be the same or not?
I feel like, I mean, yeah, Shabbos is important, but I feel like Pesach comes like once a year.
Okay, so maybe they're just
like extra.
So maybe it's different because it's a once a year thing. Yeah. Right. Okay, very possibly. Let's also look at the nature of the mitzvah of Shabbos, which is not our subject necessarily here, but is there a specific mitzvah to eat challah on Shabbos? So it's unclear. It's kind of part of a larger mitzvah of having a seuda, of having a meal, right? So it might be a different type of mitzvah than matzah, which you really have to eat the matzah itself. It might be different, right? Also, the idea of eating a meal on Shabbos is also part of a larger category of oneg Shabbos, of enjoying Shabbos, which we don't have that same parallel of matzah. So we have to really think, right? Is this the same or is this not? So we're opening up all these question marks. We're not answering them now. We're just exploring. We're just opening up the questions. Okay, keep going, Roberta.
Okay. Even the poorest of Jews, on the eves of Passover, until he reclines like free men in remembrance of the freedom on a mat and at the table.
Right, what does this clarify for us? What does Rashi help us with here? How does he help us read the Mishnah?
He connects the top half of the Mishnah with the bottom half, right? So what did making sure a poor person has four cups of wine? Well, okay. He clarifies that even the poorest of Jews goes with the first half, right? We had that question about where to place the period.
Interesting. I actually read Rashi the other way.
So, okay. So, I mean, maybe I'm wrong, or maybe I'd read it differently in the Hebrew, but
right. It's not, like, it's just, that's how I read it. That I assumed Rashi was talking about the other. How did you read it the first way? How did you read it?
So what I understood him to say was by placing even the poorest of Jews, he's saying, you might think that a poor person would approach the matzah with appetite, regardless of how much he'd eaten earlier in the day, because he doesn't have access to that much food. And so we're not worried about a poor person with limited access to food spoiling their appetite. However, a person should not eat close to mincha, even if they are poor, right? Even if you would assume that they wouldn't be spoiling their appetite. Instead, even they have the deadline of not eating until they recline like a free person.
That's a beautiful interpretation. I don't see it in the words of Rashi, but I think it's beautiful. And I think you could have said that, and maybe other interpreters do. The only reason why I would think maybe Rashi doesn't say that is because the statement he's commenting on, even the poorest of Jews, the word, he doesn't talk about appetite there. He talks about appetite on the previous comment. Do you see what I'm saying?
I guess I'm assuming that the not eat, I'm ascribing the same reason to both not eat, which maybe right. I shouldn't be.
I mean, it still could apply. Well, the way I read Rashi was that, because right after even the poorest of Jews, he says on the eve of Passover, until he reclines. So to me, that was a clear indication that he's actually connecting the poorest of Jews to reclining, to the statement that comes later. Yeah. I mean, it could be debated. That's how I read it. But other thoughts on that, on reading Rashi closely? No? Okay, what else does Rashi add here? He adds things that we might know, we might take for granted, but he's answering, why do we recline? What are we acting like on the Eve of Passover? We're like free men, right? That was not stated in the Mishnah. We might know that, but it's not clear from just reading the Mishnah alone. And then also, why do we want to be like free men in remembrance of the freedom, right? So on a mat and at the table, so how you do that, how you recline, right? So there's a lot of details here that Rashi adds that would not be clear for the mission.
On a mat, are we saying you're sitting on the floor?
Yeah, so it's interesting. I'm not sure.
Is that then reclining, like how?
Well, so I don't know what he means on a mat and at the table. So like maybe you're sitting on a mat and eating at the table. I don't know. I can share with you my family tradition. We actually sit on the floor for our Seder. Okay. We are Sephardic, but like, this wasn't really our family tradition. We just adopted it later because we liked it.
Okay.
But we set up the living room with couches and pillows, and we all sit on a couch or on a pillow on the floor. We have our little tables with wine, and we do the whole first half of the Seder there. And then we go to the table for the meal. But so this is how I experience it. This speaks to me. This makes sense to me. Of course, you sit on a mat. Of course.
You're like, you hope no one would have like approached that.
I'm proud of it. Okay. I think it's great, by the way. Great tradition to adopt.
Yeah.
Yeah, we do.
Still manage
to sit on the floor too. Well, or the
couch. Okay.
Yeah, it's really fun. It's really comfortable.
Yeah,
sitting at the tables for a long time is very. Anyways,
that's a great idea.
Yeah. So, little tangent there. Okay. Any comments before we move on? Questions? All right, guys, you hanging in there? This is you see how detail oriented we get. Okay, keep going, Roberta.
Four cups to parallel the four languages of redemption that are stated in the redemption of Egypt, and I will take you out. And I will save you, and I will redeem you, and I will take you in the Torah portion of the era.
Okay. So what's Rashi clarifying for us here?
What the four cups
what they are.
Yeah. What the four cups of wine are based on. Again, something we might take for granted.
Why it's four.
Why it's four, right? There's four languages of Geula, of redemption. Okay, and last comment here from Rashi.
And even one who is supported from the charity box, which are the poorest of the poor.
Okay.
So is it money?
So I don't know. It seems like it might be, it could be money. It could be a box with items in it. I don't know. But what we do know is that it's reserved for the poorest of the poor. Right. So there's actually it says the poorest of Jews, and then it says the charity, even from the charity plate. So it actually seems like there's different levels of poverty here. Right. There's the poorest, and then there's even poorer than that. Maybe it could be that there's even different levels here.
So isn't he emphasizing then that all walks of life have to observe these things?
Yeah.
And doesn't so matter how poor you are.
And that would also right. And then there's a further question of just why do we have these distinctions between the poorest of Jews and the charity plate? If they're not, maybe they're the same. And if they're not the same, then why are we using one in one place and one in the other? Right? Like it's very confusing. And this is just these are three lines of Mishnah. And look how much we've discussed. I mean, you can go on and on, and we didn't even answer any of it. We answered very few of our questions, right? We answered a few, but not many. And so now you can understand why there's so much commentary on just a few lines of text, because it's so cryptic, and just how to read it, how to parse it, and then also what all the terms mean. Like, what's mincha? We haven't even discussed that. Right? Like, what's the eve of Passover? Like, what does that refer to? And then how does that translate into our practices today? Right? These are all the conversations that we're going to have. Questions, comments, thoughts, please share anything on your mind. Okay, so
what
now
happens, yeah. I just had a question, but what happens if you have a word like not to eat a calf boiled in its mother's milk? You have chalav, it could be read as chalav. How do you know which is correct or which is the right word? It's different vowelization, but same consonants.
Great question. Chalav and chalav are very different. Chalav is milk, and chalav is a part of the animal that you're not allowed to eat. So would be very different implications. It's an excellent question, because our Torah does not have vowels. And that is all through oral tradition. That's the significance of Torah Sheval Peh, that things like that has been passed down.
Because that's two very different things, chalav and chalav.
Definitely true. And yeah, at some point in history, I don't know when it began, but at some point in history, there were records of people who kept the nikudot, the vowels. They wrote them down like in the codex form, and they passed that down. I believe it was the Ben Asher family. I could be mistaken. Maybe I'm mixing that up. But they kept very, very clear records of all of the vowels, and also even all the words, like male and chaser, if there's a vav in the word versus not, like different ways to write a Hebrew word. They counted the letters exactly in the Torah. You might even notice, if you read from the stone chumash, the art scroll blue chumash, so at the end of each parsha, it says there were this many letters. Anyone ever noticed that at the very end of the parsha? Some people are nodding. That's from that ancient tradition of the family who kept records of how many letters. So I'm digressing here, but my point is that all of these small details were recorded through oral tradition. At some point they may have been written down, but this is all oral tradition. Yeah, Leo, a question?
This is sort of a more general question about Mishnah in general. Listening to the text, as you said, it sounds very cryptic. Is there a sense that, and you said also that it was written down ultimately because there was a fear of it being lost. Is there a sense that the reason it's so cryptic is because it had been translated orally and it almost was like a case of, I don't want to say broken telephone, but like that maybe these sentences had been more clear and more complete at some point, and what we're left with here is the result of generations trying to pass on something that was only oral?
Definitely possible. This is all, you know, these are the questions that academics and people doing PhDs, you know, try to answer. So I'm not gonna be able to answer it, but I think it's all possible. You know, that maybe, yeah, maybe this is a reflection of the fact that it's oral. It could also be some of it is just the nature of Hebrew, that Hebrew is also more condensed. Like even in modern Hebrew, if you say lo, don't do something, it's not clear you can't do it or you shouldn't do it or you don't do it in reality. Like there's sometimes it's also just Hebrew, but it definitely could be related to the fact that it was passed on orally. Yeah. Other questions. So now let's flip to the next page. We haven't read the Gemara yet, which we'll get back to, but just read the very first paragraph of the elucidated version. I'll tell you that this is Sefaria's translation. So it could be debated. You know, that's also every translation is interpretation, but just read how much easier it is to go through this. I mean, it makes sense. They added a lot. And so you have to know that when you go to a website like Sefaria or you go to any translation of the Talmud, look at what they're adding in. I mean, they make it readable. They make it make sense. But look how much interpretation is there. That's a ton of information that has been added in. So you just have to realize when you, for example, Sefaria, I think it's brilliant what they do. They have the bolded and the unbolded. And the bolded is the actual words as close to the translate as possible. And the rest is the addition that makes it flow. So you got to really experience how challenging it was and then how different it is reading it like this. Okay, anything else? So I think we're gonna pause here because I feel like this is a very natural breaking point. But the next class is going to build on this Mishnah. And what we're going to do is we're going to enter now into the Gemara. And now, again, this is the later generation of people further analyzing this Mishnah. They're going to address some of the questions that we discussed. So we will we'll jump right in. If anybody had any further questions they didn't want to ask, you know, in front of the whole class, but you want to stay on for a more extended conversation, you're welcome to stay. With that, thank you, everyone.